Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is a guest on Janet Mefford's show to discuss surrogacy. Why should we be opposed to it?
Welcome back to Janet Mefford Today. As we are all aware, there have been remarkable advancements in reproductive technology over the years. But with those advancements come new ethical challenges. And one of the modern trends in reproduction is gestational surrogacy, in which a woman becomes pregnant and then delivers a child to another person or another couple. My next guest, though, has pointed out that as excited as we might be and rejoice in the creation of human life, there are serious ethical and practical problems with this approach, even for pro-lifers, that really need to be both understood and discussed. So we're going to do that now with Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse. She is founder of the Ruth Institute, a global nonprofit organization focused on keeping the family together and protecting the rights of children and helping the millions of people who have been harmed by family breakdown. She's written a great article about it. It's gotten lots of traction online. It's called Why Everyone Should Oppose Surrogacy. Jennifer, it's just great to have you here. How are you today?
I'm doing great, thanks. Thanks so much for having me on.
It's my pleasure. You say that you are an outspoken critic of gestational surrogacy, and for a lot of pro-lifers, they think, well, wait a minute, shouldn't we be in favor of this? Why do you say that it's important to be a critic of this approach?
Well, you know, the reason this came up is that I now live in Louisiana, and we just passed, in Louisiana, under the surrogacy contracts had been illegal. And they just put through a bill that would make them legal. And this is exactly the question everybody asked. You know, look, we're good pro-life people. We believe in making babies and having babies. And so why are you objecting to this? Well, there are a number of problems with just surrogacy and surrogacy contracts. The big pro-life reasons, are several in my article that you mentioned, I've got pro-life reasons to oppose it. I've got pro-woman reasons to oppose it. I've got progressive reasons to oppose it. But the pro-life reasons are, you know, first of all, quite often the doctor will implant multiple embryos in the surrogate and hoping that, you know, some of them take. And if they all take, then the gestational mother will be under pressure to abort some of those children. And in some cases, there have been cases, Janet, where it has been in the contract. The commissioning parents put in the contract with the surrogate, if we tell you to have an abortion, you must abort. And so that it's unbelievable. You know, it's a whole, we're producing the baby we want. You're here as part of the process of giving us the baby we want. If we find there's some fetal defect or something wrong, or there's too many and we don't want to deal with it, you owe it to, it's your responsibility, gestational surrogate mother, it's your responsibility to kill the babies we tell you to kill. So that's a problem.
Yes.
That's a big problem. Then it's also the case that sometimes people create quote-unquote excess embryos. And then what happens to those excess embryos? Well, they are either frozen or they're destroyed. And if they're frozen, right now, Janet, nobody even knows how many frozen embryos there are. I don't know of any reliable number on that. But eventually, those and think about it, those frozen embryos, those are human beings. Those are tiny human persons who were created because they're going to grow up to be somebody's son or daughter. That's why people go to the trouble of doing that. Well, now you take that child and you put them in frozen storage and you come back for them, what, when you're ready for them? Or you don't come back at all, or they're donated to science, or they're destroyed finally. You know, so the ethical status of those frozen embryos is a huge problem that should give pro-life people plenty of pause about going full bore with surrogacy.
Oh, you're totally right about that. Well, when surrogacy generally takes place, I don't know about the statistics on different ways they've done this. For example, you'll have some surrogates who are, from my understanding at least, that are biologically, the child is biologically belonging to a different man and a different woman. And then you also have cases where there's a donor egg. I mean, how generally does surrogacy tend to work in terms of whose baby it actually is? And how many of those times are actually situations in which the gestational mother is the actual mother?
Well, now that's a very good question. How many questions? The short answer to that, Janet, is I don't think anyone really knows. You know,
wow.
The infertility industry generally is not required to report accurate statistics about their activities. So we don't really know how many surrogate children are born, and we don't really know how many are born in the different ways that people can be born through surrogacy. But generally speaking, there are two types of surrogacy. One that is called gestational surrogacy is where the egg is a donated egg, and that egg is fertilized by, you know, there's somebody's egg, somebody's sperm, the embryo is created outside the body, and then it's implanted in the surrogate for her to gestate. So she's called the gestational mother or the gestational surrogate. She is unrelated to the child. She is, has no genetic relationship to that child, okay?
Right.
And so that's called gestational surrogacy. And it, you can be that can be done by a married couple using their own egg and sperm. It can be done by a married couple using somebody else's egg or somebody else's sperm. And when that happens, it's called third-party reproduction because there's a party not who's not going to be the parents of the child, who's not going to raise the child. There's a third party outside of that relationship. And then, of course, if you have same-sex couples, or particularly if you have two men wanting to be parents together, they have to use somebody else's egg, obviously,
right,
because they don't have an egg. So in all those cases, you've got third-party reproduction. Somebody besides the intended legal social parents has contributed their gamete. And there's another type of surrogacy, which is where the gestational mother's own egg is used. And that is, some people favor that because it's cheaper, you see. You don't have to take the egg out of anybody's body. You don't have to do anything special like that. You just take the sperm and you implant it in the woman.
Right.
And then after she gives birth to the baby, she gives the baby to the commissioning couple or commissioning individual, and they give her money. Now, Janet, what has exactly just happened there? What did she just do?
Well, she sold her egg. I mean,
she sold her baby.
She sold
her own baby, okay? She gave birth to a baby in order to sell it. What is that? That is the buying and selling of human beings.
That's right.
Why are we even thinking about this? Why are we even considering that this is an okay thing to do? And the real hardcore advocates of surrogacy point to that as being the best way to do it because it's so much cheaper. See, it's so much cheaper than retrieving an egg from yet another party. See?
Well, yeah, and so, you think about organ donation, for example, and how there are laws against selling your organs for money because of the ethical problems. I mean, this is much worse, selling your baby for money, your rental womb, and it's, you know, you might have good intentions, so I really want to help this couple. That's what they always say, but it's creepy. I mean, just on that level, money for babies, I just find it very, very creepy.
Well, it's worse than creepy. It's wrong. Okay,
let's just say that too.
This is wrong.
Right.
This is wrong. And I don't understand why people in the progressive side of things don't see how wrong it is. I mean, what did we go through to get rid of slavery in this country? I mean, and slavery, it's not just that people were mean to the slaves. I mean, if everybody had regulated the working conditions of the slaves and all the masters were nice to the slaves, it still would be wrong.
Exactly.
It still would be wrong. So the fact that I love the baby and the intended parents love the baby and we all want to be nice to the baby, that's beside the point.
Yes.
How much you want that child, that's beside the point. The point is you don't buy and sell other people. End of story.
Exactly.
You know, just end of story.
You said it right. And as you say, and I love the way you put it in your article, the gestational mother is used for her womb and then is legally and perhaps emotionally set aside. Oh, you're not needed
Absolutely.
Anymore. Yeah, I mean, you just created
right.
a human life and now you're cut off from it.
You know, one of the links that I have in this article, by the way, this article is on the Ruth Institute Facebook page. People can find it there. It was originally published at The Blaze, so I have a regular column over at The Blaze, so you could find it there as well. One of the links that I put in this article, Janet, was to a documentary, 15-minute documentary video about surrogacy taking place in India. So there is a big industry for surrogacy in India. Why? Because it's cheap.
Exactly. Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse from the Ruth Institute. She is founder there and has penned a wonderful article. You ought to read it. You should read it. You should pass it around, why everyone should oppose surrogacy. And Jennifer has done a tremendous job of outlining all of the reasons, not just as pro-lifers, but also people who are pro-woman and even progressive, the reasons why we should oppose surrogacy. You were mentioning before the break, Jennifer, this link that you put in the original article on The Blaze where you were talking about this situation of surrogacy in India, because this is a cheap way and people can get money this way.
Yes. The video is called Outsourcing Embryos. Okay. And so, you know, just think about that. We outsource things to third world countries because it's cheaper to get things done. So that's what's happening. Well, one of the really heartbreaking scenes in this video is the doctor. There's a doctor who runs this business of surrogacy, and you know, she's got the women there who are, you know, carrying the babies to term, and she promises the customers, I mean the commissioning parents, she promises them that they can come and pick up the baby at a particular day and time. Well, how does she do that? She schedules C-sections for each and every one of those babies. Okay? She can't be fooling around with, you know, a 12-hour labor and delivery. No way. She's got them lined up. She opens them up. She takes out that baby. Somebody cleans them up, and the baby's gone, just like that. And, you know, my goddaughter just gave birth to her third child, and it was very important to her to have a vaginal birth. She had originally had a C-section. It was very traumatic for her and so on. So she, you know, you think about how much effort we go into as women, as mothers here in advanced countries, trying to give life to our babies in the most natural possible way, you know, right. For their benefit and for our benefit. And look at how we're treating those women in India. Oh. You know, we're just going to cut it open and rip out that baby and send it home with the people who paid for it. You know, it's just, it's so disrespectful of everyone involved. So I should think that any progressive person, any pro-woman person would just be appalled by that.
Right. No, absolutely. And from a progressive perspective, you also had hit upon another big issue, supposedly a big issue for progressives, which is the exploitation of women. I mean, how is this not exploiting women as well? And what about the differences? This is another thing that you raised in the article, which I think is significant to discuss. The differences between the adoptive process versus the surrogacy process. It's not exactly analogous.
Yes, that's right. That's right. You know, most people don't think it through all the way to the end, you know, on these type of topics. You know, they'll say, well, as you probably know, Janet, I'm an adoptive mother as well as a birth mother, and I was also a foster parent. So, you know, I'm kind of familiar with these different ways that people become mothers. But if you were going to try to adopt a child from a birth mother, and she has chosen you and your husband maybe, and said yes, when the baby's born, you're the family I want my child to go to, you know, and we're making this plan and we're working together, and this is what we think is going to happen. Janet, as far as I'm aware, in every state in the United States, that birth mother has the opportunity to change her mind after the baby's born.
Yes.
And, you know, so in other words, when you put the baby into her arms, she is allowed, she is almost required to hold that baby and be really sure this is what she wants to do, right?
Right.
And a lot of times, they don't want to do it. They change their minds all day long. You know, I know plenty of hopeful adoptive parents who have had that experience, you know, where the birth mom changes her mind. That's totally her right, totally understandable. The law honors that as it should honor that. But if you take a woman who has agreed to be a gestational surrogate for somebody, she, as I described in the case in India, she may not even be allowed to hold the baby, and she has no opportunity to change her mind. And there are cases that have come up already where the woman looks at this, often it's a guy who is, you know, a single guy. There's one very celebrated case, I shouldn't say celebrated, very notorious case of a guy who commissioned this woman to carry triplets for him. And then he got cold feet and said, well, I don't really want triplets. Why don't you, you know, selectively abort them? And she's like, no, I'm not going to do that. And,
right.
And then she finds out that there's a reason he's 50 years old and nobody will marry him. You know, he's living with his parents. He's partially deaf. He's like not really suitable. And she's like, no, I'm keeping these babies. I don't want this guy. You know, but there's no opportunity for any kind of second thought or concern on her part. So that is a way in which gestational surrogacy is really quite different from the way in which we try very hard to honor the wishes of birth mothers in other situations.
Right. Well, in that case, there may be some who will hear this and say, well, then we should change the laws. What do you think, though, is the right reaction? And in many respects, we're talking about something out of Brave New World where you're making babies in labs. And I mean, it's all coming to pass in our day. But the genie is kind of out of the bottle. And how in the world do you stuff it back in the bottle? What do you think the solution is to some of this? Maybe passing some laws that would protect women or doing more work on the ground as pro-lifers saying this is not a good thing for society.
Well, the second, for sure. For sure we need to be saying this is not a good thing for society. But actually, you could very easily put a stop to surrogacy. You could do it very easily because it is a creature of the state. It is a creation of law. When somebody says, I'm going to engage the services of a surrogate, what they really want is a baby to which they have undisputed legal title. That's what they really want.
Yes.
And so if the law were to say, look, we don't know what you guys did over here, but the woman who gives birth to the baby is the child's mother.
Right.
That is the law. And if she decides to give the baby up for adoption, that's up to her. And we have rules about that. But the woman who gives birth to the baby is the child's mother. That put an end to the whole thing.
Yeah.
It would, with that law in place, and that, in my opinion, should be the law. Now, the reason we got the bill in Louisiana, as you know, is a pretty traditional, very pro-life place.
Yes.
The reason that it came about is their law had been that we do not honor surrogacy contracts. When a woman gives birth to a baby, she's the child's mother. So there was a couple in one of whom was a state senator, the other of whom was his wife, who is a longtime lobbyist, so they're a very well-connected political couple in state politics in Louisiana. Well, they needed, for whatever reason, they needed to use a surrogate or felt they needed to use a surrogate. They went to California to engage a surrogate, and that's the Wild West. Everything's legal in California.
Yes.
So they went to California. And they used the services of a surrogate. Their child was born. And then under Louisiana law, they needed to adopt that child. Well, they were offended. There's no other way to put it. They were personally offended that they had to adopt what they considered to be their own child because it was her egg and his sperm and so on. I can kind of understand what they meant.
Yeah.
But the fact is, if they could not have, without that adoption proceeding, there would have been no chance for them to have the child at all, right?
Sure.
I mean, what they wanted was the undisputed legal claim that this is our child and nobody else's. And so without that legal procedure in place, surrogacy would dry up and go away. I mean, it needs the state in order to function.
It does. That's very true. And that's what, I mean, this is so informative, I think, Jennifer, for pro-lifers to consider and to, you know, get a little bit more deep into the reasons, like you mentioned, pro-life reasons and pro-child reasons as well, pro-woman reasons to oppose surrogacy. And also on the heels of that, to emphasize again and again, we would not have probably the demand for surrogacy or even adoption were we not more pro-life as a nation and we stopped killing the children in the womb who deserve to be born through abortion. This is all tied together.
Yes, it is all tied together. We have this idea that we can turn everything into a commodity. You know, the baby's a commodity. If we don't want it, we kill it. If we do want it, we buy it.
No. Yeah, I know.
No. That's no foundation for a pro-life world. I mean, we need to be unashamed of what we believe. What we believe is that every single human person is a gift from God.
Yep.
and a gift to the parents and a gift to the world. And we cooperate in bringing that child into being. But we didn't make it, you know. And the fact that every person who exists because God loved that person into existence. That's what I believe.
Me too.
And I am not ashamed to say that that's what I think.
Well, I agree with you wholeheartedly, Jennifer. And a wonderful article, ruthinstitute.org, the article, Why Everyone Should Oppose Surrogacy, a must read from Dr. Jennifer Roback Morrison. So great to have you here, Jennifer. I really appreciate your work, and it was so great to have you. Thank you again.
Thanks so much.
All right. You take care. And thanks so much for joining us here on Janet Mefferd Today, as always. JanetMefferd.com.
You've just been listening to Dr. J and Janet Mefferd discussing surrogacy on her radio show, Janet Mefferd Today. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.